Welcome to a new series where we take a look at ventures in the photography and media sphere that didn't quite go to plan. Hey, it's Colin. Okay, so let's wind back a few years, not too long though, back to the ripe year of 2011 when the Lytro light field camera was announced. Okay, this thing was hot. It had the ability to focus after you had taken the photo. To Lytro and to the rest of the photography world, that had the potential to change everything. And it sure kicked up a fuss in the media. There were headlines such as "Shoot now, focus later," and "Lytro's light field camera creates living pictures." With headlines like this, it is truly sure to have a long and prosperous life in the photography game. Launching at $400 US, a rectangle-looking device with an f2 aperture and an 8x zoom, there's really nothing more you can want, right? I'm asking you a question, guys, come on. The camera launched to critical acclaim. This changed a lot of things in the world of photography. But was it a gimmick? We're not too sure. Obviously, have your own opinions about it down below. Now, according to Lytro, the camera featured 11 mega rays on its sensor.
Mega rays!
And as far as megapixels are concerned, they said it was hard to determine the crossover, so to speak. You guys know what I mean. The conversion of mega rays to megapixels is quite confusing and I'm not sure it's very applicable, so we're unsure. Okay, so we've all calmed down after the original light field camera came out. Then the Lytro Ilum. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Ilum. Ilum. Ilum? Ilum. 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 Ilum.
Illuminate.
We'll say Ilum. The second camera had come out and it looked like quite a big one. It had a 30 to 250mm lens with a constant aperture of f2. You'd be paying a very high price for that on a DSLR or a mirrorless camera these days. So that in itself is quite outstanding. So the Ilum had a 40 megaray light sensor. Now, if you were curious, this is 4x the amount of light when compared to the previous Lytro camera. It only had 2 buttons and then 2 dials. It had dual electronic rings for zoom and focusing on the front, and on the back, it had a touchscreen, you know, fancy little doo-doo-doo, and then I think it was an autofocus lock and a function button. So, nothing too special here. Good stuff. $1,599 at release. Now you can find it for about $400 Australian. They were ready. They had 2 big cameras in the game. What was to happen next? 2 years after the Ilum was released, Lytro Cinema came out. Yeah, you looked at me, didn't you, buddy? Cinematographers beware, or be interested. I don't know. The Cinema apparently had a 755 raw megapixel 40K resolution with 300 FPS. Now that's what I call a cinema camera. Now onto my good friend Josh, who will dissect all things Lytro 2016 and beyond.
Thank you, Alex. I've totally been sitting here the entire time. In 2016, Lytro's John Rosenthal confirmed that they were heading out of consumer imaging. The cold hard fact was that Lytro was competing in an established industry. We didn't have the resources to both continue building consumer products and invest in VR. Which was a very timely statement because in the previous year they had announced Emerge, their VR rig. It seems the need for VR content vastly outweighed the need for consumer cameras. You can call the beginning of VR for Lytro the beginning of the end. So before 2017, there was only one way to view your living pictures online, and that was through pictures.lytro.com. So unfortunately now, the website has gone dark, and it redirects you to a random admin page where I'm assuming you can buy the domain. So if you want that, wink wink. So this marked a major change for Lytro. This website was a staple piece for their initial marketing and overall brand image. So we're not too sure if there are many active Lytro users when the website was still up. We do still find this quite disheartening. Where did they go? Why weren't there many people using it? So I guess this can be a big lesson for other photography companies that they should allow for flexibility with their software and their pictures and their formats and their, all this other stuff. But it was quite hard for Lytro because they were pioneers of a technology that nobody else had used before. So it's 2018. Then came the final nail in the coffin. Pow pow! There were a lot of rumors going around that Google had acquired, or was in the process of acquiring, Lytro. Unfortunately for the company, this was not exactly the case. Google had instead taken over their light field patents, which would then pave the way for Google to create their own VR stuff. And Lytro had given over all of their employees to Google, or most of them at least. In a blog post, Lytro said this: "It has been an honor and a pleasure to contribute to the cinema and virtual reality communities. But starting today, we will not be taking on new productions or providing professional services as we prepare to wind down the company." Wow, very sad. So at this present time, in August of 2018, we really have no idea what light field technology is gonna end up being used for, or if it will have any relevance to photography at all. Right now, it's been mostly used for VR stuff, and really have to give a big kudos to Lytro for, you know, creating this technology that, you know, can be used for other stuff. It's a good thing, don't you think that?
Yes.
Thank you. They showed us how to get a startup going, they showed us how to market stuff, and they've really given us a big story to talk about and to create content on. So thank you, Lytro. And we'll catch you in the next one. Bye-bye.